So we're continuing on with our 70s horror class Canadian classics. So we got cut off last time. We just finished, or we're pretty much going to finish Cronenberg's Rabid, and now we're on to Rituals, 1977. Director of this one, don't really know a lot about. Really didn't do much. This was his biggest film. This one is cool. This one actually is kind of even though it's older than Deliverance, which was 74, I believe. This is very much the same way, about five doctors who get airlifted into the backwoods of British Columbia or the Yukon or someplace like that to go fishing, and somebody's picking them off. Somebody's setting up little traps for them and all. This one stars most notably Hal Holbrook. And
Yes.
this whole film was shot in chronological order, which only makes sense in this thing because it looks like they were actually out in the deep. And this one here, again, some other actors might be notable or recognizable. I can't really, I've seen some of them. I couldn't really place them, but hell of a story. I have to say, I enjoyed this one even more than Deliverance. I think it all comes down to your expectation of what you believe, but Hal Holbrook does an awesome job of leading these guys through. A lot of it has to do with the sanctity, the brotherhood of the medical profession, doctors taking care of doctors. They start talking about a lot of their backgrounds. You know, everything comes out when you have guys that are bearing their soul to other guys about past sins and so on and so forth. But I have to say, this one, without giving too much away, was a real pleasure. I think this one had more of a twist to it than this one definitely had more of a twist to it than Deliverance. Deliverance, you saw what you knew what you were getting into and getting out of, if you know what I mean. This one here, definitely a lot more, in my opinion, a lot more savage.
Well, I think I think Deliverance a little bit cashes in on the fact that they have Burt Reynolds, who's on the upswing at the time, and then they don't knock him off, not to spoil anybody who hasn't seen the movie from like 74, but they certainly write him slightly out, and he's no longer the hero or
Yeah,
the
and you have, I mean,
explorer,
even back then
right?
you've got John Voight, Ned Beatty, and I think it's Ronnie
Ronnie
Cox.
Cox.
I mean, Ronnie Cox, you can do with what you will. Same with Ned Beatty, but I mean, John Voight and all them would have been pretty big ticket items back in 74. Nevertheless, this one, Hal Holbrook was already well established when this came out. I mean, I think he was already in his late 40s, early 50s when he did this one.
Oh, no
And
question. Right before Fletch lives.
Yeah, so 1977's when this one came out, and I remember my dad going on about this one. Oh, you got to see Rituals. Oh, you got to see Rituals. So I remember the case on this one had a guy wrapped up in barbed wire, and in fact, it was brutal. And I think I tracked down a VHS copy when I was dating a girl out in Langford, and we watched it on a TV that had no sound. But I really wanted to watch this. So while the rest of the crew was, I'm standing by there listening to the little faint sound that was coming out of her TV. So that was my first experience with this one. But I have to say, there were some scenes in this that, if you're not used to violent films at all, definitely kind of take your breath away. Again, it's not a gore fest by any stretch of the imagination, but a really well calculated, I won't even say it's a horror film. I mean, I guess it would be suspense thriller. I mean, there's definitely elements of horror in it, for sure.
Well, I mean, very much like the theme we've been beating or the drum we've been on for the last couple of weeks. These are, whether they are original or inspired by, these are the Canadian versions, if you will, of other movies. And
This one actually also originally wasn't called Rituals. This one got renamed and it was called something else. And last week, when we were going to do it, I knew what it was. This week, I can't remember. But again, this one had a few incarnations on VHS and Betamax under a different name, and then finally the box art and Rituals is what it was released under. But I believe originally theatrically it wasn't called Rituals. Again, this one has
yeah,
a
it was
great
called The Creeper.
Creeper. Okay,
Yeah.
and again, if you
Which
watch, if
relatively
you,
makes no sense.
yeah, if you watch this, it really doesn't. I mean, I would have accepted if they had even said the Prowler, I would have felt. But again, that's a different movie from probably around the same time. Or no, that was about 1980, I think that one. But definitely worth seeking out. This one is, I'm definitely not calling it folk horror because it's not, But definitely.
Much as, you know, our friends at The Last Shark or Grizzly are second cousins to Jaws. This one is clearly a second cousin to Deliverance.
Yes, most and definitely.
And not to bring up two, not to bring up not one, but two friends of the podcast. If you're looking for a nice triple feature, throw in Deliverance, throw in Rituals, and then throw in Don Coscarelli's Survival Quest.
Yeah, Survival Quest. Even you could probably even do, I was going to say John Woo's Hard Target or...
then you're getting into the Most Dangerous Game.
Most Dangerous Game stuff, but this one, in a way, I mean, humans are being hunted in all cases.
Yeah, and then the other friend of the podcast, it gets a mention in Stephen King's book Dance Macabre as a standout, you know, one of 100 horror fantasy films that he really likes, and take that from the director of the critically acclaimed Maximum Overdrive.
Brilliant.
Rituals, everybody.
Rituals. So again, if you haven't seen it, hadn't heard of it, check it out. I think we watched this one on, I saw this on Shudder recently, but I've seen it a bunch more times. They used to play it on TV once in a while. I don't know. I think you can find it on Tubi right now, actually.
I'll throw it in the comments. What's that?
Or else you can visit our friend Kevin Martin's place in Edmonton and check it out there.
Absolutely. So,
77. Now we're moving on a little stretch to a different type of kind of horror thriller, a little more supernatural. Well, definitely a lot more supernatural. This is one of my favorite films of all time. And I can tell you that this film is one that I never heard of when I was 15 years old. And I think I skipped, I fake being sick school to stay home from school, you know, licked your palms, did the whole Ferris Bueller thing. I'm sick. And this was the 1 o'clock movie. So keep in mind, like, it's broad daylight. I'm faking being sick, laying on the sofa. This is the 1 o'clock movie. This movie scared the shit out of me to the point that I was looking over the back of the sofa. And I think that lies in the fact that it's so incredibly plausible. And I'm talking about the Peter Bedak 1979-1980, The Changeling. Not to be confused with Clint Eastwood, Angelina Jolie, Changeling, which is a totally different beast altogether. This one's 1979. This one, when Canada had Genie Awards, this one's racked up. I think it won 9 or 11 Genies. It cleaned up that year. This one stars George C. Scott and his wife at the time, Trish Vandermeer, legendary actor Melvin Douglas, John Calicos, a lot of Canadian characters, Barry Morris, that you'll see in lots of Canadian films. And this one was all shot here, close down to Gastown here. I think it was shot in Shaughnessy, actually, Vancouver, the Shaughnessy area. And actually, now that I'm here in Vancouver, I'm looking around looking for these buildings, and you can see the Lyne Strait Bridge and all that kind of good stuff. So very cool. So basically the premise here is George C. Scott's character loses his wife and child at the very beginning of the film. And he, in order to keep his sanity, he basically rents himself an old heritage home in downtown in Vancouver. He's a concert pianist, and he wants to sit in there and lock himself in there and pound away at the piano and play second work. So while he's in there, something starts contacting him through his loss of his wife, and it's the ghost of a little boy who's trying to get him to solve his murder. Like I said, this one has no sex, no real violence, no gore, no, you know, not even hardly any bad language. And it is, if you believe in the spirit world, this one is truly terrifying. There's some scenes in here I remember trying to watch. This used to be the film that when I was in grade 8, 9, 10, we'd have girls over, even though back then it was dated. And this would scare the ever-loving shit out of them. So the girls would clutch onto you, right? Again, one of my all-time favorite movies. I became a huge fan of George C. Scott and watched everything that George C. Scott ever made. Again, can't say enough great things about this. Peter Medak's direction on this film is absolutely outstanding. There are some camera angles that are done here that are so effective. There's some moments in here that are so effective. If you go back and you believe in the paranormal, supernatural stuff and all that kind of good stuff, you know, they've done their homework on this script. And like I said, I can't say enough good things about it. So huge recommendation from me. This is one of the cornerstones of Canadian supernatural horror thrillers. And yeah.
Well, and then much like some of the Bob Clark stuff we've talked about previously, it's It's got every, as most Canadian films do, every technical requirement that you need for anything, right? It's just, they could be telling a comedy. They happen to be ratcheting the emotion in a different way. And I think we've talked about this before where, it's literally one of the best hide behind the couch movies where, it's a great ghost story. It's everything Ghostbusters wants to be.
If I could get a soundtrack, it would be this soundtrack, because the score for this film is absolutely brilliant. It is used so effectively, like it's scared. Just listening to it scares the shit out of you. So to me, the music in this is just as iconic to me as listening to John Carpenter's theme for Halloween or Mike Oldfield's Tubular Bells for The Exorcist. This one here, very underappreciated, but I think that the musical score on this one and just the soundtrack in general makes this film what it is. This film wouldn't be nearly as powerful without it, but there's so many great pieces put together, from the performances of the actors to the incredible direction. The cinematography on this one is absolutely brilliant. So smart, so effective. This is filmmaking, as far as I'm concerned. Whether this is a horror movie or not, this is filmmaking done right. This is incredibly effective. Now, by today's standards, even though it's a film, it's a Canadian film from 1979, 1980, it's still effective. Like it's still dated incredibly well. I mean, you're getting away from the style and all that. I remember watching Charles Bronson in Death Wish, the first Death Wish, and kind of being taken out because that was made in 74 as well, the first one. And it's so funky because you've got a lot of retro 70s style. Even though this one's made in 79, 80, or released in 80, made in 79, released in 80, it doesn't really rely that heavily on style, which I kind of like. It's just like when you watch The Shining. A tuxedo is still the tuxedo is still a tuxedo, right? You get away with that stuff. And I think when you get back to those blaxploitation movies and all that, where they're making everything so funky, or even movies today that that rely heavily on style, it may be good for the time, but it's going to eventually date it badly. And that's something that you really can't say. Save the camera work, because you're filming nowadays, we're filmed all digital. Now, going back to 35 millimeter or 16 millimeter film, there's a warmth to it, just like listening to your favorite record play on our old crappy record player. So you have that warmth there, but at the same time, it hasn't really dated. Like once you're into the film, you're into the film.
And I don't mean this as a slight in any way, but the most literal dating thing about it is the fact that George C. Scott is the guy in it, right? It'd be no different than if it was John Wayne. It'd be like, I gotcha. Right. And it's only because he's literally, he's also,
And I swear to God, George C. Scott was born old.
Yeah. So, yeah. Unless you've seen Strange Love, Strange Love, you think he is exactly what you think he is.
Totally. Because he died in 99 and he was only 70 years old. And like, holy crap, he looks way older. I mean, he was an incredible alcoholic, but at the same time, I figured he was way older than that. Way, way older than that. But Hollywood dealing movies can be a dirty business sometimes and hard on the soul. So there you go. But again, Melvin Douglas, I think this is the second or third to last movie before he died. He died, I think, after being there with Peter Sellers. Like I said, this is, if you have not seen this film is free on so many platforms. You can watch it on YouTube. You can watch it on Tubi. You can watch it on so many different free platforms. Iconic cover. Once you've seen the cover, you probably walked past it when we had video stores 1,000 times. I know for every video store that I ever had, I made sure I had a copy of this. And I sold about 1 billion copies of it over my time in the video industry, just because on recommendations alone. In fact, I used to have a policy. I said, if you didn't like it, I'd give you a free rental. So,
well, and I can vouch for somebody who rented from this man. He's recommended both Rituals in VHS and The Changeling in VHS format. So that's how far back
this goes.
This guy's been recommending this horse shit.
It
does. I don't mean that absolutely in any negative way. It's good. These are great movies.
Right? So again, if thumbs up from me. If you haven't checked this one out,
they're fantastic.
Central Canadian. Yep. So whether you like horror movies or not, you don't have to be a fan of horror in order to enjoy this film. So there you go. So moving on from that, we're going to jump up to 1981 and a film I remember my parents telling me they went to. And this now, 1981, you're getting into the heart, the really beginning of the slasher genre. So you're getting into Friday the 13th. You're getting in, of course, Black Christmas predated that, but you're starting to get into a lot of these slasher films. And early on after Friday the 13th, which was 1980, Sean S. Cunningham, we got into a Canadian film called My Bloody Valentine, which of course was redone in 2009. And again, the premise is really quite simple on this one. It's a cave-in that happened and on Valentine's Day and some misdeeds done. And there's a guy from the local mine with a pickaxe and his gas mask who's taken out teens left, right, and center. This one, again, back in the day, I mean, you even see it done today. If you watch some of the movies today, is that you all you do is you find an iconic figure. So, I mean, we have a miner here. We have a guy in a hockey mask. We have, you know, at one point you give him that and you give him the cool enough weapon and you got yourself a franchise, right? This one didn't spawn a sequel. And again, I remember my parents saying that they hated this movie. But actually, as it's dated, I mean, I think Cowper was the guy who played the maniac in this one. But actually, I watched this with my son about a year ago, and I have to say that actually, I really did quite enjoy it. There's definitely some Canadian charm to this one, and I think it also is, which we have it on this list, is indicative of Canadian cinema at the time. And actually how much we could actually compete on the international market for stuff like this. So, I mean, yeah, there's a lot of American production values in this, but overall you're dealing with a largely Canadian content on this one. And, you know, this is our first crack at really other than Black Christmas at the slasher genre. And instead of a stab or knife, I mean, we've got a guy with a pickaxe. So, I mean, what could be better than that?
No,
big teams and using all the same stuff they talked about on screen. Don't have sex. Don't wander off by yourself. don't be anything but white.
You know, that, when has that changed? Unless, you know, you're casting Busta Rhymes. you're being nice. Facetious. You're being facetious because, you know.
But no, Pickett I have
Smith. To say, Jada Pickett Smith was also in Gotham. She played Fish Mooney.
Nice. So I remember my parents telling me about them. They went to the theater, so this was a major theater release at the time.
Like, I mean, and this is what I call, I mean, very much other, we've talked about Black Christmas and, you know, a couple other Canadian horror, you know, Cronenberg and whatnot. This is, as far as I'm concerned, you know, being a Canadian, an overtly Nova Scotian tale. The first one.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
It's produced there. It's
an East Coast tale for sure.
Yeah, I don't mean that in an offensive way, but that, you know, if we're going to get, it's Canadian and then we're going to break it down. Whoa, 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 whoa. They're not running around mountains. They're fucking around in Nova Scotian mine. That's definitely exactly what they're doing here.
Most definitely. And again, if you have anything to do with the mining culture, there's some really cool things in there to look at. Some things that you could probably call bullshit on, you know, if you, your father, you worked in the mines and all that. But again, to me, again, another part of Canadian cinema that really demands to be seen. I mean, I wanted to make a shout out here to Dave Cronenberg from earlier, because we said Rabid and these guys here. I mean, this is kind of the five that I've kind of, to me, when we were coming up with this list, we're at the most five now. With Cronenberg, we could have done Shivers. We could have done Videodrome.
We'll do live watch alongs.
Rabbit is kind of his most iconic, other than Videodrome, which is its whole different beast. I think we'll cover a Cronenberg episode and we'll bring that one up then and bypass Rabbit. But we'll probably do that. We should probably do that, Rob, when the new one comes out. I was just reading about today.
Coming out before Sakunka, so.
Yeah, I was reading about that today. So I can't remember. I know Kristen Stewart's in it. I can't remember. I think the only reason I remember that is they were talking how much graphic.
Vigo, of course, is
Vigo. There we go.
And then Leah Seydoux is probably what you'd call the. For those that are out there that are speaking Cronenberg, that's probably the muse in this one, where, you know.
as opposed to Leah Seydoux.
Offensive come from a woman. It's probably going to be Leah Seydoux, not Kristen Stewart. You know what I mean?
Well, you get the and Kristen Stewart. So that and, if you guys watched enough movies, especially of the horror genre, that and can mean so much. It can mean either they have 30 seconds of screen time or they're in the whole thing and they die. They die like halfway through. So it's always, I mean, we used to laugh because we'd take movies and we'd say, and Ernest Borgnine, and Robert Vaughn, or somebody that would always die in the film, and Cameron Mitchell, you know, as Bud.
Yeah.
So, but anyway,
no question.
That and thing can mean so much, but it's either they have a really small role or they're going to die early on in it. So that's.
Or they're a celebrity and they're not gearing down. For Canadian,
you're down.
Hey,
call out to some of my film buddies that are actually going to be watching this. So I know for sure Reed Anderson is going to be watching this. So call out from you. I hope you're enjoying the show. And Evan Berland, if you're watching the show, shout out to you too. If you aren't, then you're going to probably, Reed will probably tell you about it. And you'll have to watch it now. Tell your friends, tell everybody, tell them we got Charles Bronson on the show. Or that Mexican guy that looks just like Charles Bronson, but doesn't sound like him.
I've got some shout-outs, too. If you have impotence, like some older people like Michael have, try Blue Chew. It's a thing that you chew and you get a hard-on. It's fantastic.
Try it out.
Okay,
today.
Let's count down. I'm gonna cut it off in 10 seconds so we don't get cut off inappropriately, right?
All right.
But,
good night, everybody. Come on.
Come on.
I got to do that Naked Gun thing.